Thank you all for coming to hear about the state of humanism, particularly how it relates to the AHA. Gary reminded me that I get up here and I start babbling and I forget to tell people who I am. So I'm Rebecca Hale, and I have the good fortune of being the president of the American Humanist Association. So thank you very much. Part of the reason that it's such an honor is because of the individuals who are sitting out there in the gallery and our membership, which has now grown to over 30,000 members and supporters. So yay, AHA. The next hour and a half is going to be a whirlwind tour of what goes on at the AHA. It doesn't all happen in the office on T Street. Some of it happens in other places, but Roy and the rest of the staff keeps it all in line, and they keep it going in the same direction most of the time. And they keep everybody with a good feeling, and that's really the heart of humanism. So I want to thank the staff for that and for everything that they do. You'll be hearing from staff, you'll be hearing from board members, you'll be hearing from directors. Pay attention, because at the end, there's going to be a test question. So you want to pay attention because you want to be able to answer the test question. I'll make it a bit of a take-home quiz. I'll tell you what that question is going to be right now. What is your opinion of the state of humanism? And I'm going to want your feedback. I want to know why you feel like that. I want to know what we could do better, because it's important for us to know not just what we're doing well, but what we might be able to do better to help you feel warmer and fuzzier about humanism and to energize you so that you can go back to your communities and feel good about the time you spent here and the time that you devote to the American Humanist Association. You folks are us. And maybe that's a little bit self-serving, and maybe that's a bigger compliment than I deserve, because the members of the American Humanist Association are superior human beings. I don't mean that in a condescending way to those people who are not members of the American Humanist Association. But I do know that when I go to different kinds of events around my own community and around the country, the people that I see time and time again rolling up their sleeves and getting involved in making this a better country are my fellow humanists. And that means a lot to me. It means a lot to me to be up here, and it means a lot to me for all of you who are members of the organization and support us. So thank you very much for that. As always, I've fallen off my notes, so it's going to take me a minute to figure out where I was. You're going to, if you look in your program book, they've put this wonderful little graphic in here that tells you some of the progress that we've made. It tells you where we were actually probably a few months ago, because our numbers are up from then also. But we've got over 190 chapters now, chapters and affiliate chapters around the country. We have over 271 celebrants. We have over 421,000 followers and likes on Facebook. And we have over, I think it's now about 32,000 members and contributors to the AHA. So, big time. This graphic is here for you to brag about when you go back home. So, get to bragging. It's important for people to understand the value of the organizations that they belong to. Another thing that I'd like you to pay attention to as you go through listening to all of the different things that we're going to present to you is that AHA is embarking on its next strategic plan. So we are going to be asking you, and we're going to have a few minutes specifically devoted to the strategic plan, but we want you to give us your feedback. You are the best and the brightest. You are the most creative. You are the fun and the heartfelt and the critical and the cynical. And we need you to give us your insights, your ideas, your suggestions. Where do you want this organization to be in 10 years, 15 years, and 20 years? What will you do to help us be there? And what do you want us to do to help you be with us? So that's something that, as you're listening to all these other wonderful things that are going on, please bear in mind that we need your brain power. We need your insights. Let's see. I think I've probably done my 4 minutes, and if I haven't, the next speaker will be happy to use that time. So I'm going to pass this podium over to Roy Speckhart, our executive director. Thank you, Roy.
Thank you. Although, actually, John is going to go first. So, John Hooper, our treasurer.
I thought I got out of it for a minute there. Good afternoon. I'm pleased to announce that income for 2014 was the highest on record. Both budgeted and revised projected totals were met or exceeded in most income categories. Significantly higher income was seen in contributions, bequests, and legal settlements. Even though the association ended the year with $130,000 more in cash than at the end of the previous year, general expenses were a little bit higher than expected. Increased spending choices were made in several areas, which were all approved by the board or were circumstantial, like fixing leaks and that sort of thing. AHA received over $2 million from 7 bequests, almost all of which was designated to the Humanist Foundation. The foundation itself had a banner year. Net assets increased from 44%, from $4.3 million to $6.2 million. The market value of investments in cash grew 58%, from $3.9 million to $5.8 million. The amount of money distributed to the AHA grew by a similar amount, from $146,000 to $231,000. In mid-2004, Fred Edwards was hired as a part-time director of planned giving for the foundation, and you'll hear more from him later. AHA's strong performance has continued throughout the first quarter of 2015, with most areas meeting or approaching targets. While it's too early to accurately measure progress in most categories, a significant large bequest has put the association in a very good cash position year to date. A revised 2015 budget has been approved by the board. The most significant change is a reduction in projected income of about $260,000, with accompanying changes in many related expense categories, and this is due to the Coalition of Reasons going independent of the AHA. Also, the addition of a paralegal or entry-level attorney for the AHLC is necessary to meet the increasing and important demand for legal work. And finally, the 2014 association audit has been satisfactorily completed without issue. Thank you.
Thank you, John. As most of you know, I'm Roy Speckhart, the executive director of the AHA, and I'm here to say that the state of humanism of the American Humanist Association is strong indeed. And by the numbers, you heard some of those numbers already, but our membership levels over the last 15 years have either stayed the same or increased every year, now at the all-time high of 31,000. The e-zine that goes into your inboxes every week, thehumanist.com, with senior editors Jennifer Barty and Maggie Ardiente, is now going out to 52,000 emails every week. And twice that number are going online and getting the content directly. This makes it the source for online original humanist news. And you heard about our rising Facebook numbers. Last year when I was here, I said we'd hit the 250,000 mark. But we're well on our way to exceeding the 500,000 mark before this year is over. And we must be, thank you. And we must be doing something right, because former Representative Michelle Bachmann said we're nearing end times. She warned us, we'll suffer the consequences as God will soon lift his hedge of protection over pagan America. I guess that's us. Well, the need for a philosophy that emphasizes empathy, compassion, egalitarianism, all through the lens of reason, has never been greater. Part of that is because the religious right isn't going away quietly. They're thwarting our efforts at trying to make progress. You may be aware that there's a piece of legislation trying to do something good for survivors of human trafficking. However, they're undermining it by not allowing a single penny of it to go toward abortion services, even though thousands of human trafficking survivors experience rape pregnancies. This is immoral. The religious right is immoral. And you're familiar with the Indiana's Religious Freedom Restoration Act, the RFRA bill, that was trying to put in place protections for businesses so that they could discriminate against other people and use religion as an excuse. That's wrong too. And unfortunately, it's not just in Indiana. There are about 19 other states that have this going on, and other states are trying to put them in place. We've got to stop them. Also, as we're entering campaign season, we see Mark Rubio and Victor Cruz as presidential candidates vying with each other to decide who disbelieves the most about everything we know about science, evolution, and climate change. It would be funny if it wasn't so sad. But the truth is, we've got our work cut out for us. So it's a good thing that the media, that politicians are paying more attention. They're looking for our opinion. They're getting on board with us. They're asking for our involvement. And this gives us a chance to make change. If we could focus our efforts, if we can work with others, we can raise the prospects of humanism. So now, I'd like you to hear from others who are going to show you all that's happening on your behalf to raise the prospect of humanists and humanist viewpoints all across. You're going to hear about our magazine. You're going to hear about our chapter programs. You're going to hear about a plethora of difference-making programs that are working for you. Thank you, and let's get it started.
Hello. I am Louis Granados. I'm working with Humanist Press. It is the publishing arm of the American Humanist Association. We do printed books. We have a special focus on e-books. We try to make money for the organization so that it can pay for all of the other wonderful things that you're about to hear in the next hour. And we do that not by asking for anything for free, but by making available to you some really good books. That you will enjoy and you'll learn a great deal from. You should check us out at humanistpress.com, and you should do it before you leave Denver, because this week we're having our conference special, 99 cents for an important book by Lyle Simpson with the provocative title, Why Was I Born? IRS says you were born in order to give them more money, but Lyle Simpson has a different take on things, which you should explore. We were especially honored this year to have Barbara G. Walker, one of the most distinguished feminists in America, come to us and say, I want Humanist Press to publish my next book. It's available out front, Belief and Unbelief, very powerful stuff in here that you really need to read. Those of you who are poetry fans, we have a book out that just came out within the last month by Tasha Walker, a musician with the band Ellery. Beautiful, moving poetry. Those of you who are not poetry fans ought to take a look at this anyway. It might change your whole outlook on the genre. This morning we heard from Will Gervais about the negative stereotypes of atheists, something we all know a lot about, and he spent 95% of his time talking about the problem. Part of the solution is we need to let the world know that we're not really such terrible people after all. And we have a book coming out, and that's exactly what it's about. It's called Godless Grace. It's by David Orenstein, Linda Ford Blakey. It's profiles of people just like you and me in fact, some of you are here, working in their communities, one after another, after another, after another, doing really good things, and we don't actually have two heads after all. Godless Grace, coming out this summer. We have a book from Roy Speckhart coming out this summer. What's the name of that book again? Creating Change Through Humanism. It's a little bit incongruous to talk about the Bible of humanism. We don't really have such a thing. But if there were such a thing, it would be Creating Change Through Humanism. Gives you the past, gives you the present, and most importantly, gives you the future of this movement. You really have to have it. You remember that little red book from Chairman Mao? Well, Roy's has written a lot better than that, I guarantee it. And finally, at the end of the year, we have a book coming out about Christmas. There's lots of debate every year about Christmas and whether it's okay for atheists and humanists to celebrate or not. What there isn't every year is a lot of facts supporting any of the sides in this debate. This year we have a book coming out called The Myths That Stole Christmas by David Kyle Johnson. I've read an awful lot on this subject, and I can tell you by a mile, best thing I have ever read is the manuscript of The Myths That Stole Christmas. He's got research, I'm at the end of the year, research, thoughtful analysis. You owe it to yourself to get this, and so happy reading. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Meryl Miller. I'm the Communications Associate at the American Humanist Association. I would like to tell you that in the past year, we have seen tremendous success in promoting our mission, brand, and programs in the media. We have over 60,000 media hits on Google News alone. That's just Google News. And we have been covered in prestigious national outlets, such as the New York Times, The Washington Post, USA Today, Associated Press, CNN.com, Fox News and FoxNews.com, MSNBC, Time Magazine, The Huffington Post, Religion News Service, and so many others that I won't take up your time naming them all. We have provided information and insight to reporters on numerous issues involving church-state separation, as well as the discrimination faced by humanists and atheists, along with many other topics of pertinent social issues. Recently, Roy Speckhart did an Associated Press interview on humanist chaplains on college campuses, and this interview was published in the New York Times, as well as hundreds of local newspapers all across the country. Roy was also recently interviewed by the news syndicate McClatchy Company on the topic of legislative prayer, and this interview also ran in hundreds of local newspapers all across the country. So we're definitely getting our message out there. Another story that received extensive coverage was our legal center's success in making the U.S. Air Force remove its requirement that enlisting airmen swear an oath using the phrase, "So help me God." And this story was covered in news outlets from the Washington Post to Time Magazine and Al Jazeera America. And our own Monica Miller also did an interview on this issue on the MSNBC show News Nation with Tamron Hall. And many other spokespeople from AHA have also appeared on national news sources to promote our initiatives and provide commentary on many of our issues, such as the growing number of irreligious Americans. For instance, Roy Speckhart and Dave Niosi have both appeared on Newsmax. This is a very conservative cable and online news station. But they have been invited on to discuss all kinds of issues ranging from the discriminatory nature of the phrase "under God" in the Pledge of Allegiance to recently the need for the U.S. Supreme Court to recognize the validity of same-sex marriages. Letters sent by our legal center as part of our ongoing pledge boycott have been mentioned in such media outlets as the Boston Globe and the Inquisitor, among many others. and a statement by David Niosi and Monica Miller on the unconstitutionality of a South Carolina public school's fundraising for a Baptist church was included on Fox News' show Fox and Friends. And Roy Speckhart and Maggie Ardiente have both appeared separately on FoxNews.com's spirited debate with Lauren Green to discuss the number of nuns, that is people who identify with no particular religion, in this country. And Maggie Ardiente was also quoted in such news outlets as the Washington Post, Religion News Service, and Think Progress on politicians who do not believe in God but are not openly atheist. So overall, our media relations outreach at both the national and local levels has successfully strived to establish AHA as the go-to source for accurate and reliable information on issues related to humanist discrimination, church-state separation, and many other pressing social issues. Thank you so much.
Hi, everyone. David Niosi, I am legal director of the Appignani Humanist Legal Center, and I'm going to give you a quick overview of some of the things we've been doing at the Legal Center. I invite any of you to come and chat with me at any point over the weekend if you'd like to go into more detail on some of this stuff, because we've been doing an awful lot. In fact, to say that we have been busy would be a gross understatement. Monica Miller and I have been busy litigating cases and handling an awful lot of legal work. We, in fact, have gotten so busy, and I think the AHA has built a reputation very much as a go-to organization for church-state separation and atheist-humanist rights, that we are getting inquiries constantly now from all over the country, especially from young people who realize that we can defend their rights and will do so. So that's very encouraging. We're bringing on a new staff member, in fact, a third attorney, a litigation assistant, to assist us because the volume is increasing so much. We have right now about 11 lawsuits pending across the country. This is more than double what we had a year ago at this time, or just about a double what we had a year ago this time. We can expect in the coming year some very interesting decisions coming probably out of federal court in Oregon, where we represent a federal prisoner who is trying to form a humanist group and has been unable to do so. From Bladensburg, Maryland, where there is a large Christian cross that has been in the middle of a traffic median there for almost a century, where we are challenging that on Establishment Clause grounds. That decision is likely within the next year. Carroll County, Maryland, we are expecting one of the first legislative prayer cases to come out post-Town of Greece, if you're familiar with that, the Supreme Court case that was decided last year, legalizing legislative prayer, sectarian legislative prayer. This case in Carroll County is going to try to narrow the understanding in federal courts of what is and is not allowed. We are expecting a decision in Douglas County, Colorado this year, right here in Colorado, where there is a school system that is just really into Jesus and all that stuff, and we are trying to beat back that governmental religiosity, and I think we'll be successful. In fact, we've already settled part of that case against one defendant, and we're hopeful that the rest of the case will come along in the coming months. We've also settled this year a case in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, against a transit authority there that would not let atheist humanists advertise. We entered a consent decree there, and we settled a case in Fayette, Missouri, where there was another school system that is kind of out of control. In the coming year, we have cases that we'll probably be filing soon in Gwinnett County, Georgia, in Birdville, Texas. We'll be challenging another law in the state of Texas where they require parental permission to opt out of the Pledge of Allegiance. There's a saying that you don't mess with Texas, right? Well, all we have to say is if Texas thinks it can mistreat atheists, let me make it clear, we will be messing with Texas. The AHA will be there. And there's, as I said, lots of other activity, too much to cover in the few minutes I have here, but please come and chat with me anytime this weekend. I'd be welcome the opportunity to talk with you about it. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Jennifer Bardi, the editor of the Humanist magazine and senior editor with Maggie Ardiente of thehumanist.com. So I'm here to report on those two programs of the AHA. 2 years ago at this meeting, I believe I kind of said, you know, we're ready to launch, we want to launch this humanist kind of media hub, combining several AHA publications. And then last year, I think I basically said, well, we did it. And so I'm here today to say, I think we're doing it really well. So far in 2015, thehumanist.com has averaged 86,000 visits, over 113,000 page views per month, and making this the most viewed AHA website. We're publishing new content every day, so we're usually publishing 1 to 3 new articles. And I quickly want to acknowledge the staff of the AHA, the writing staff, who are largely responsible for generating those. We have weekly editorial meetings and that are actually quite a bit of fun. And those staff writers will generate ideas and usually commit to writing an article a week. So I want to thank Merrill Miller, Megan Hamilton, Matthew Bulger, Jessica Shao, Rachel Berman, Meredith Thompson, and Peter Bjork, along with our regular columnists and outside contributors. I wanted to mention Louis Granados writes a wonderful column, Clay Ferris Naff, and Joan Reisman Brill. And along these lines, I'd like to extend the invitation to all of you members. If there's something in the news that you want to comment on from a humanist perspective, if you go see a film that strikes you as very humanistic, please consider writing this down. You know, internet articles are 600 to 700 words, and we would be very happy to consider them. The key, though, is timeliness. So, you know, we need to receive those so we can make a decision and publish. So I invite you to do that. I think Roy mentioned that our weekly email that goes out on Friday that provides kind of a digest of all the articles goes out to 52,000 subscribers. Now, there's something that I have to admit, which is that I am addicted to not doing Twitter or Facebook. Not particularly proud of that, but luckily our social media person, Megan Hamilton, does a wonderful job of promoting humanist.com and humanist articles on Facebook. And the AHA's Facebook page, if you don't know, it's a very lively, lively site. Roy mentioned we've got, you know, close to 500,000 likes, which really translates into just a lot of interaction going on that site every day. Now back to the world of print, the Humanist magazine is turning 75 next year. So and I'm really excited about working on this anniversary issue. I'm soliciting former Humanist of the Year to contribute. I think it's gonna be a really stellar lineup of people. You know, when you look at that list of Humanist of the Year, the bar is so high and it doesn't waver. So I think this is going to be a really good opportunity for us to promote humanism through this issue, and I'd love to consider doing advertising for this issue of the magazine. And along those lines, you know, I have a dream, and it's a weird dream, but whenever I fly somewhere and I'm in the airport, I go to the bookstore and I look at the magazines and I think, you know, maybe I'll get some magazine that I don't subscribe to, The Economist or The Atlantic, and I always think, how great would it be for the Humanist magazine to be at the airport? and actually, I was talking to Jim Simpson and his daughter, Julia, about this yesterday, and apparently they know someone who might have some information, so stay tuned. Lastly, I just want to say goodbye to someone. Lisa Zangerl, our graphic designer, is leaving us, and we're all very sad about that. We're sad to see her go, and we're really wishing her the best. Lisa does all the graphic design for the AHA, and she does it so well, and she's an all-around awesome person. So I think I want to just end with a round of applause for Lisa, wherever she is. Thank you so much, Lisa, for everything you've done.
Hello, everyone. I'm Maggie Ardiente. I'm the Director of Development and Communications for the American Humanist Association. I'm the senior editor of thehumanist.com. I coordinated the conference, and I'm also in charge of lobbying and legislative work at AHA. I'm probably tired all the time. No. But So I'm reporting on behalf of Matt Bulger, who is our full-time lobbyist at AHA through our sister organization, the Center for Freethought Equality. And I'm really proud of the work that he's been doing over the past year. More than ever, we're making the connections that we need to make in Congress to really support a lot of the progressive legislation that we want to see, like same-sex marriage, like reproductive rights, like the environment, like climate change. So we do more than just advocate on behalf of nuns, non-religious people, atheists, humanists, and seculars for our viewpoint, but also take that further step and join with other organizations, religious organizations as well, to support the legislation that really matters. So we're very excited about that. Some good numbers: 15 action alerts sent over the past year on a variety of issues, 20,000 unique actions by members like you who receive our emails and learn more about us and take action on issues that really matter. Matt has personally met with 75 members of Congress and their staff to let them know about what humanism is and that there is a huge community of humanists that are dedicated to supporting progressive legislation. So we're excited about that. We're also continuing our work and development and relationship with groups like the U.S. State Department, Office of International Religious Freedom, and the U.S. Commission on Religious Freedom to address the serious problem of atheists being discriminated against and even killed abroad. We're very concerned about that issue, and we're letting you know that we're letting our government officials know about these issues, so we're happy to do that. Last year, we held our first congressional briefing on the topic of humanist chaplains in the military with the Military Association of Atheists and Freethinkers. So we are getting a lot of pushback with the idea of a humanist chaplain, largely from the evangelical movement, which makes no sense to me because there's something like 12,000 Southern Baptists in the military, and yet they have 437 chaplains that serve them. There are more atheists and humanists in the military, and we have zero chaplains, okay? This is something that obviously has to change. We need to have the number of people who are serving in our armed forces get the necessary counseling and support that they need that I think a humanist celebrant or a chaplain would be able to provide. So we're hoping that that works very soon. Absolutely. And finally, I just want to say very quickly that I'm very excited about National Day of Reason. Like I mentioned, we got a congressional resolution by Myconda to recognize National Day of Reason. And Darwin Day this past year was a huge success. We had Representative Jim Himes who introduced the bill, and we got nearly 20 co-sponsors. So every year it keeps increasing. We're so excited about getting members of Congress who are actually reasonable and support evolution. It's amazing. And then, of course, the Secular Coalition for America issued a companion resolution in the Senate. So that was the first time that happened. So we're excited to be working with SCA, with a lot of other groups that are lobbying on Capitol Hill on your behalf. So thank you so much for everyone, again, who is taking the time to respond to those action alerts, to write to your members of Congress. They really make a difference. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Bishop McNeil, and I am the political coordinator for the Center for Freethought Equality. The Center for Freethought Equality is an adjunct of the American Humanist Association that's dedicated to lobbying and electoral advocacy. We significantly increased humanist activity on the Hill by building key Washington coalitions, and we've established a permanent lobbyist, Matt Bulger, who is dedicating his time fighting for the issues that secular Americans care about, for example, the separation of church and state and protecting civil liberties for all Americans. Over the course of the 2014 election cycle, the Center for Freethought Equality grew to over 12,000 members, with over 1,100 signing up for volunteer activities. And another hundreds of more signing up for specific campaign-related activities to make calls or canvass for our endorsed candidates. Now, this time last year, when I was given this update, we had less than 4,000 members. 2 years ago, we had none. So to be where we're at now is pretty impressive. So the primary approach for the Center for Freethought Equality is focusing more on increasing our influence during elections in support of candidates that are openly non-theist, and also candidates who are not only allies in Congress, but leaders in separation of church and state and civil liberties issues. We can do this through through our PAC, which is the Free Thought Equality Fund. And the Free Thought Equality Fund is the only active secular non-theist PAC that has the ability to give money directly to candidates. And so that's something to keep in mind. Some of our notable winning endorsements from 2014 were Colorado's own Congressman Jared Polis, who sponsored the Humanist Chaplain Bill in Congress, and also Representative Mike Honda, who recently introduced the National Day of Reason resolution to Congress this year. We also endorse, yes, please. Another one of our winning endorsements was a state representative from Arizona, Juan Mendez, who many of you know, who's an open secular humanist and was proud to tout that on the floor of the General Assembly a few years ago. So all of those candidates won. The Free Thought Equality Fund also endorsed nine non-theist candidates running for Congress and also state house elections. Unfortunately, none of these candidates won. But rest assured, it had nothing to do with their religion and everything to do with a bad year for Democrats running in Republican districts up against incumbents. And so it's something to keep in mind. The PAC donated over $34,000 in direct contributions to our candidates. We gave out another $21,000 in bundled contributions. And finally, we spent $55,000 on independent expenditures for our endorsed candidates. That's a total of $110,000 that we gave away in 2014 for all of our endorsements in our first election cycle and our first year as a PAC. So where do we go from here? I will be able to wrap it up. So where do we go from here is the question. The recently created Free Thought Equality Super PAC will significantly increase our ability to raise funds, effectively support candidates that are running for public office, and gain greater influence towards changing the face of American politics. A effective strategy being used by some PACs today is called a hybrid approach that allows us to raise unlimited amounts of money through the Super PAC account and also to still give direct contributions to candidates through our traditional PAC account. And that is the system that we have set up as of now. So we have implemented this structure with the goal of electing an openly secular humanist candidate to Congress in 2016. And I've spoken to many of you about this particular election that humanists should all pay attention to. From this platform, I can't mention any more, but please come and find me. I'd love to talk to you more about this campaign and our organization and the work that we're going to be doing in 2016. So thank you so much.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rachel Berman, and I'm the grassroots coordinator for the American Humanist Association. As of April 2015, as Maggie and Roy both mentioned, we have a total of 120 chapters and 75 affiliates for a total of 190 local groups. In December of 2014, the American Humanist Association announced a new and exciting long-term volunteer program called the Volunteer Regional Grassroots Coordinator. There are a couple out there, so I want to say thank you for that. There are currently 10 regional grassroots coordinators throughout the country, and they offer support, resources, and guidance to leaders of local humanist groups throughout the country in order to help them grow and thrive. The American Humanist Association is in the final stages of adding two new and exciting resources for local groups, a manual for effective tabling and a guide for parades. A manual for effective tabling is a comprehensive manual which will be available both online and in print. The manual includes best practices for the tabling process and photos of both effective and ineffective tables. A guide for parades, which will be available in both print and online as well, encourages local groups to participate in both booths and local initiatives in both local and national marches and parades. The guide includes step-by-step instructions for creating a professional banner, as well as examples of these banners and signs. Both resources should be available by the end of the summer of 2015. In an attempt to have more of a presence in the secular community, AHA has been tabling at many regional conferences throughout the United States. In 2015, AHA has already tabled at the Northeast Conference in Science and Skepticism in New York and has committed to tabling at the American Ethical Union Conference, Imagine No Religion Conference in Canada, The Amazing Meeting in Las Vegas, DragonCon in Atlanta, ApostaCon in Dallas, the World Parliament of Religions, and Skepticon. So if any of you are planning to attend any of these upcoming conferences, please stop by the table and say hi. I would love to see all of you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Stephanie Downs Hughes, co-chair of the Feminist Caucus, and we are feeling so good about being nested in the AHA. There is such cordiality, cooperation, and constructive work that we're doing together. And we are so proud of our women leaders. We're very represented, probably as never before, in programs of all kinds. And this is true also in the chapters where more and more women are coming on the boards. And we also are being more active politically. By now, most of you have heard about how hard we have been working, not only in New Mexico and Illinois, but in other states where we are working for ratification of the Equal Rights Amendment, which was passed at the national level. But we have a strategy to get it ratified by three more states so that it will finally become a constitutional amendment. And there are so many opportunities for creative work along with move to amend to undo corporate personhood. We're asking each of you. Many of you already have these two critical sheets, which can be a program that we're asking each of you to run back home. It's called Movement to Establish the ERA. And you can use this as your script for the program that you schedule. And if any of you don't have that, please stop by our table out here. I'm going to ask my new co-chair, Amanda Kniff, to take over from here.
Thank you, Stephanie. Where are my feminists? Woo! You should all be raising your hand, and if you don't think you're a feminist, come talk to me and I'll make you one. So, I have a couple things I want to quickly mention that we're doing. I'm really excited to be co-chair of the Feminist Caucus. One is women are 50.8% of the population, but we are totally underrepresented when it comes to political office. So I have this neat little flyer that gives you some statistics about what we can do before 2016 to get women more educated about being in political office, basically that you don't have to be qualified in any particular way, that anybody can do it, as we've seen, and most women are more than qualified to do it. We want more women involved, and that includes men encouraging their wives, their sisters, their daughters, and say, hey, I think you'd be good at this. Sometimes women just need that encouragement. I also want to get you guys to do something that isn't really connected to the AHA, but I think could help us in the long run, and it's a grassroots effort to get a woman on the $20 bill. This weekend is the final weekend to vote on the four finalists, and you can come to our table and pick up a sheet, or you can go to womenon20s.org. And what they're doing is trying to raise awareness that women have never been on our paper money, and I think this is great, because as we bring more awareness to how discriminatory our money is, we might be able to take another shot at In God We Trust. Finally, if you are a feminist, or if you are concerned or excited about the things we could do with the Feminist Caucus, we have a great little sheet, talks about some of the programs we're doing, and we ask you to come fill it out and come talk to us at the table. We're really excited about challenging not just the AHA, but the skeptic, the atheist, everyone, and getting on board, encouraging more women in the local groups and in political office, and really getting women to have equal representation. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Marilee Harrison, the new president of the Humanist Society. We certify humanist celebrants and chaplains, and our numbers are growing. As usual, I have opinions on why that is, and I'll share them with you. As an out and proud humanist and atheist, I'm often asked, Where do you get your morals? How do you have meaning in life? And as humanists, we have answers to those questions, and we have a framework within which to act on them. And the Humanist Society is part of that framework. So Rebecca had a test question. I'm going to ask you for a raise of hands. I'm assuming all of us in the room were born. How many of you have ever known someone who died? Okay, all right, that's pretty universal. I'm going to offer you two ways in which we can serve our community during that time frame between birth and through death, and why we should do that. And I'm going to do it quickly. When Santa Fe County started issuing same-sex marriage licenses, I went down to the courthouse to see if I could be of service. When I arrived, some liberal ministers were doing a group wedding, and they were smooth and accomplished, and I thought, oh, they have this in hand. They do not need me. But then they asked the couples to pray with them and asked the couples to come to church for the sake of their marriage. I looked at the couples, and I saw discomfort on the part of some of them, understandably so. So I decided I would offer a secular option for them. I went down to the front of the line in the clerk's office and told them there would now be a secular option. As I did so, a couple came to turn in their paperwork who had been married, and they said, if we had known you were going to be here, we would have waited. So that's all it took for me to stay for the rest of the afternoon and officiate 15 weddings. On Monday, I came back just in case there might still be someone who wanted to be married, and I officiated 41 weddings that day. So the Supreme Court, I hope, is on the verge of extending marriage equality nationwide. And we can be there to serve our communities in this time of celebration. I'll give you another instance. Someone who attended one of my weddings kept my card, and when her father passed away, she called and asked if I would officiate the memorial service. He had been very helpful and influential in the community and the wider area. So a governor of a nearby Native American Pueblo came to speak. A nuclear scientist offered a eulogy. Community members and family members were able to do so as well. Because we came from a humanist perspective, we were able to weave a beautiful celebration of life. Afterward, the family told me that this was perfect. This is just what we needed. We can be there for our communities when tragedy calls us to do so. Our numbers are growing, the numbers of non-religious. We must not cede our ceremonies to the religious. We need to be there in our communities to serve in times of tragedy or celebration. Please come to humanist-society.org to find a celebrant or to become a celebrant. And I'll be outside afterward to answer your questions. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kristen Wintermute. I'm the executive director of the Humanist Institute, and I'm going to spare you the rap that I was going to do. I'll just follow Bishop's lead. We were going to come up here and give you a little rap, but I think it'd be too ugly, and I don't have time. So the Humanist Institute is really pleased to announce that we're close to realizing our vision of being the center for humanist education, drawing on all branches of humanism. We started out with a graduate level program, which is continues to be our core program in helping people become leaders, leaders like Maggie. There's many graduates in the room, Bart Warden, the executive director of AEU back there, Carol Wintermute, who was in the first class, many of the people that are leaders today and that are here and have been movers and shakers in our movement came through our graduate level program. We're pleased to be able to offer a one-year option for those who don't want to do the full 8 sessions and get a certificate in humanist studies. It gives you a really good foundation in humanism. I highly recommend the one-year option, but I recommend even more the 8 sessions. This, as I've announced in previous years, we've been working on online courses. These are self-guided courses. I recommend them for people who are new to humanism and want to know what the deal is. What is it all about? What's humanism and ethics? What's humanism and religion? And they're just great introductory courses. You can use them with your small meetup groups. They're perfect for people who are like, I just want to know a little bit more about it. Part of what we do at the Institute is we cooperate with a variety of different organizations, one being the Institute for Humanist Studies, and we're very proud of the contemporary topics. They're topics highlighting the ideas coming out of the think tank. The one we have online now is Humanism and Hip Hop, and don't let the title fool you. It's more than you think it is. I'm looking forward to future senior fellows in June. We're hoping to have Humanism and Race, which I think will be a fabulous course. Monica Miller's writing that course. She'll be speaking tomorrow. Sikavu, I know I always say her name wrong. Did I? She is also doing a course on contemporary topics on humanism and feminism from an African-American point of view, and I'm really excited about that course. Of course, we offer trainings. We have a political activism training that was written by Amanda Kniff, who you just heard from. And the most recent development that we've done is a webinar in cooperation with the Opinioni Legal Center. Dave and Monica are doing a Secularism Today, and in Minneapolis, we did it as both a webinar and an on-site training, and we actually got continuing legal education credits for that. I was really pleased about that development. Last, we piloted the first time in March an on-site program that was beyond just celebrant training, which I saw many of you that have been to our trainings and benefited from those, but we also did a training with LGBTQ and humanism and atheism and how those two communities can learn from each other and how they're very similar in many ways. And then again, we did the secular law, and I will get off the stage so that somebody else can have my 22 seconds. Thank you.
I'm Fred Edwards, a former executive director of the AHA. And now I'm director of planned giving for both the AHA and its endowment fund, the Humanist Foundation. Now, the Humanist Foundation is managed by an independent board of trustees, which oversees the investment of funds received through bequests from those who have chosen to remember the foundation in their wills or their estate plans. Now, when bequests are put into the Humanist Foundation, they become a gift that keeps on giving. This is because the foundation, instead of just spending the money immediately on humanist projects, invests it. And the foundation trustees are wise investors, having last year beat the market averages in the various investment categories by 1%. The annual earnings from investments are next passed on to the AHA to support its programs and create new ones. This means that when people name the Humanist Foundation in their wills or other estate plans, they are ensuring that their gift will live on to benefit generations to come. To show how well this has worked, AHA Treasurer John Hooper reported to you at the beginning of this meeting that the foundation's net assets had increased almost 50% in 2014 from the previous year, and the earnings distributed to the AHA grew 58%. So we are now looking at an endowment worth about $7.5 million. We hope to continue that growth of the Humanist Foundation to ensure that humanism and the AHA will thrive and grow through the 21st century. But what does this have to do with you? Well, I have a sad story to tell. Well, at this conference, I received a call from a woman whose father had just died. She called me because among her father's mail was the letter that I had sent out to all AHA members, inviting them to remember the AHA or the Humanist Foundation in their estate plans. And she said to me, "I'm sure my father would have wanted to leave you a bequest. It would have been just like him to do that. But he died without a will. And now I want you to please remove him from your mailing list so that we won't have to receive any more of your mailings." So, while her father's estate will go to the next of kin, as it is in her state, his dying without a will means that not one cent will go to the projection of his humanist values into the future. He stopped advancing his values when he took his last breath. So please make sure that you have your own intentions written in a will or other estate plan. I'm 66 years old, but I put the AHA in my will when I was half my present age. I have longevity in my family, but I drive America's highways, so I'm ready now. So consider investing in your values, leaving even a small percentage of your estate to the AHA or its endowment fund. I'm available throughout this conference if you want to learn more about this. I have information to share with you. Or there is planned giving literature at the far end of the exhibit area. Just pick up this flyer, A Future for Your Ideals, and see what you think. Humanist values are your values. And the AHA can keep on advancing your values beyond your lifespan. As the late Isaac Asimov summed it up when he was president of the American Humanist Association, "You can't take it with you, but you can send it on ahead."
Hi, I'm Herb Silverman, president of the Secular Coalition for America, and I have a will that includes the AHA. In a previous century, I joined a number of humanist and atheist organizations, including the AHA, because each was doing work that I supported. But these organizations were competing among themselves for what they viewed as a fixed pie of donors. I wanted to see the pie grow to benefit all of our organizations and the secular movement as a whole. These organizations were spending too much time arguing about labels, atheist, agnostic, humanist, secular humanist, whatever, and too little time showing our strength in numbers and cooperating on issues that affect all secular Americans. So the Secular Coalition for America was born in 2002 with a mission to increase the visibility of and respect for non-theistic organizations and to protect and strengthen the secular character of our government. We started with three organizations and all volunteers and have grown to 17 national member organizations and a dedicated staff of five. Not quite what the religious right has, but we have a good start. Since each member organization has strict limits on lobbying, the Secular Coalition incorporated as a political advocacy group to allow unlimited lobbying on behalf of secular Americans. We cooperate on the 95% we have in common rather than argue about the 5% that might set us apart. Our first lobbyist was Lori Lipman Brown, and thanks to Mel Lipman back there for playing a significant role in producing Lori Lipman Brown. Lori was housed in the AHA basement, and the AHA has become our most supportive member organization. The Secular Coalition advocates for those millions without God beliefs, and last week we had a successful lobby day in DC. We wanted to show our representatives that humanists and atheists are not asking for special rights, but we do expect and demand equal rights. The Secular Coalition is working to make our voices heard on Capitol Hill, but we can't do it alone. Your voice is important to get real change in Washington and state capitals all over the country. Your congressional representatives need to know that secular Americans like you are an important part of their constituency. But even as we fight against religious privileging on the federal level, some of the most egregious violations occur at state levels. I know. I live in South Carolina. The Secular Coalition now has 50 state secular coalitions, and we hope you'll be active in your state. As the Secular Coalition continues to grow and gain influence, I look forward to one day seeing an America that respects humanist viewpoints, and an America where the influence of conservative religion is mainly limited to within the walls of churches and not the halls of Congress. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Kevin Jago, and I'm happy to announce that in the fall of 2014, I got to step into the role of coordinator of the LGBTQ Humanist Council. And I'm excited to be the point person of this important organization that's an affiliate of the AHA. And since that time, I have been meeting with people both in person and digitally from around the country who are excited to be involved in the work of the LGBTQ Council. And help us support programming from a humanist perspective and a gay perspective. Over the past 7 months, I have begun to make connections and create new programming, like I was saying, that the council can offer to the larger humanist community. In the fall, the council was featured in several articles through thehumanist.com that you heard about earlier. Throughout the year, we have signed on to several AHA press releases representing the council and co-signing pieces of important work that are coming out of the AHA. This past January, the council was represented at the Secular Leader Summit held at Rice University in Houston, Texas, and we were a part of really important conversations there. And in March, the council held our first in-person training called Humanism, Atheism, and LGBTQ Communities in conjunction with the Humanist Institute, as you heard about shortly ago, and the American Humanist Association. And just last night, we held a reception here in Denver for our members and allies to converse and sign up and get involved. So over the next year, my hope is to connect with many, many more people doing work all around the country, so feel free to get in touch with me then. And we also hope to have a role in next year's Creating Change, which is the largest LGBTQ organizing conference in the country, as well as offering training to humanist groups nationally. So finally, we want to make sure that we are creating ways for volunteers to contribute their time through writing and organizing work to build our presence within groups around the country. If you want to get involved, please see me just outside the door with the rainbow flag, as you might guess, is my table. And I'm here throughout the entire weekend to have conversations and make connections with anybody that's interested in getting involved. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Susan Sackett. Most of you know me. I think I've been a member of the AHA board for almost 10 years, and I am also not the AHA representative, but I am on the executive committee of the International Humanist and Ethical Union, otherwise known as IHU. AHA is one of the leading member organizations that belongs to IHU. And we have chapters and member organizations and affiliates in countries on every continent, I think, except Antarctica, although we could work on that. We advocate for human rights around the world and humanist values, and we have representatives at the United Nations. I will be going to Manila in about less than 3 weeks now, I think, for the annual GA, General Assembly, and we will also have an AHA representative who will be there and supporting us and our opinions. So I'm pleased to say that I'm part of this vital work. We have general assemblies every year. Next year we're going to be in Malta, the year after that in Brazil. We'll have a big congress. Last year we had one in Oxford, England, and we had representatives from AHA who were there and supporting us. So we do international work, and it's wonderful to have AHA as a big part of that. I would not want to have a conflict of interest, but I do try to think in terms of what would be good for AHA as well as IHU. We have six members on our executive committee. Two are from the United States. One is from Belgium. She'll be retiring. We have another one from the Netherlands and the UK, Norway. I think we are the largest member organization after Norway. Like, they have something like 70,000 members and of their Norway Humanist Association. We can strive towards that and become the largest group. I think that would be a great goal for us. So if you have any questions about IHU, I'd be happy to answer them afterwards. Thank you.
Good afternoon, friends. For those of you who have not had the pleasure to meet formally, I'm Tony Penn. I'm delighted to serve as the Institute for Humanist Studies Director of Research. We're deeply concerned with exploring the nature and meaning of humanism and unpacking its potential for positive influence on private life and public concerns. To that end, since we met last, we've published two books, one related to humanism, theism, and public policy. The second concerned with ways in which humanism might influence how we behave during that period of life to death. It explores issues of relationships, education, etc. These books are published through a series we publish with Palgrave Macmillan, the academic division of St. Martin's Press. We also have a relationship with Equinox, and it's through that relationship with Equinox that we partnered with AHA to bring to you the Essays in Philosophy of Humanism. Rest assured that journal is doing well, and will continue to do well. We have a new publishing platform and limited expense for bringing this journal to you. Equinox covers all costs. So if you're thinking about this journal and you have something you think you'd like us to consider putting in the journal, go to Equinox and you'll have to go through our process. You can't send the piece to me and you can't send it to John Shook. You'll have to go through the process, but we'd be delighted to receive your pieces. We hold an annual symposium. For the past few years, it's been held on the Rice University campus. Over the next 2 years, we'll wrestle with humanism, race, gender, and class. We think it deserves at least two consecutive meetings, probably more, but we need to move on to other issues. So we'll explore that for 2 years. We've been deeply concerned with expanding the diversity of participation, in part understanding diversity and difference not as a problem to solve, but an opportunity. So we've been trying very hard to diversify our gatherings, and for us that means not only racial and gender diversity, but also some attention to those who are in the academy and those who serve our function, our purpose, our movement outside of that context as well. We are in the process of working out a relationship with the University of Humanistics in Holland and the Institute for Philosophical Research in Hanover, Germany. They share some of our concerns, and for us it's a way of thinking globally while we continue to act locally. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Jennifer Kalmanson. I'm Vice President of the American Humanist Association, and you've just heard from our wonderful, esteemed volunteers, staff, leadership, that where we are now. I'm going to ask you a different question, and Becky hinted at this earlier, to ask you, where do you want us to be in 30 years? So every 5 years, The AHA, in our bylaws, we are tasked with coming up with a 5-year strategic plan. It's that year. So we have a committee that has formed. We've met once, and we have a draft that is in progress. So the time is now. We want your input. Strategic planning is the attempt to answer foundational questions, existential questions about why do we even have an AHA? What do we want to be? How do we want to reach all of our membership as it grows? That's becoming an increasingly challenging task to make sure that we can include a greater proportion of this ever-growing number. It's a good problem to have, but it would be nice if we had your input on how you want to see us solve that problem. So, to that end, there are our pens and little note cards that look like this at each of the water tables. So as you're leaving, please pick up a note card and write on there your answer to the question, in 30 years, the AHA should ... And when you're done, just drop them at the registration desk and we will collect them, collate them, and use them as our input. Thank you so much.
All right, we actually have a little time for some questions, about which you can cover anything, or you can address the strategic planning process or ideas you have for where AHA should be going. So feel free to, there should be a mic somewhere. There. So it'll be coming right over here. So there. Mike Werner there is leading the way to the mic.
I would just like to give my thanks to everybody here, the staff, and all of you, because I know we're talking to the true believers here. All of you out there are what really makes it happen. My own wife and I, we've devoted our life to humanism, and since we've retired, we're working 24/7 at it. And I know many of you do well as well. What our strength is right now is we have an incredible staff led by an incredible leader in Roy, but we also have all of our fingers. You've heard about all these things. All of these things are being done by incredibly professionally well-done volunteers as well. We're doing it right at all levels, and we should give ourselves a hand for that.
Hi, a couple of... Well, one question and one suggestion. I guess one question is, does the AHA ever hire a public relations firm, people who are specialized in that sort of thing, to face down the issues of the way we're marginalized? And one of the biggest problems is that there are so many nuns, and yet most of them are closeted in terms of their personal lives, and people don't know them as nuns. So that's one question. Another question is a simple one, perhaps. The people who are on the podium or anybody, if somebody says they're interested in humanism and would like a relatively short, good book to go to, the only one I know of currently that I know is a good book like that is Humanism is the Next Step by Lloyd and Mary Moraine. And we also heard that there's something coming soon, and hopefully it's short and good, from the Humanism Press. But are there any other alternatives that anybody can name right now to that? So that's two pretty different questions, but I'll try it.
So in addition to our staff who have training and expertise in public relations work, we do occasionally seek help from public relations firms, and in fact, Becky and I and Maggie Ardiente met with a firm based in Colorado who do some terrific work that we might be adding to the process in order to get the very same aims that you were talking about. So I think you're right. We do need to seek professionals. And sometimes, in fact, we've had professionals among our membership at large who, including leading pollsters, who've been able to volunteer a little of their time to help give us the direction that we need. So that's been terrific. As far as books that will serve the need of educating folks about humanism, there's a lot out there that I think are useful. Yes, it's true that I'm working on one that will be published shortly, which intends to really modernize ones that have been done in the past. As much as I, you know, it was Corliss Lamont's philosophy of humanism that convinced me that I was a humanist. And reading Lloyd and Mary Moraine's Humanism as the Next Step also got me involved and energized. Unfortunately, those were originally written decades ago and don't really address some of the modern experiences of humanists and atheists across the country. And I hope that my book will start to get in that direction. But I think there have been others out there, you know, from popular authors like Greg Epstein and, you know, of course, there's the Dawkins books and the Dennett and Hitchens sort of books that have led the way. But there are a lot of other folks out there who I think are doing good work, and including the ones that we are publishing through Humanist Press that Louis Granados had mentioned.
Hi, my name is Bill Parks, and a man by the name of Will Gervais, who gave the talk this morning, said some things that were very interesting in terms of how negatively we were perceived. But he also said that the negativeness tends to go away when you know someone and so forth. So now we have a thing that I think is a dual mission. One is to alert other people who might become humanists, and there we would have a billboard that would say good without God, okay, which would get people in. But we would have another billboard that would say good works in mysterious ways, which may be less confrontational, because what he pointed out was that being confrontational was likely to harden their dislike of these people rather than help them go in.
I think he raised some really interesting questions, and I'm glad that he did, because this is something we have to grapple with as a movement when we think about strategy, right? And I think that to the degree that we're confrontational, part of that is just being honest about who we are, which I think is important. Part of that is being edgy enough that we get some attention. But I don't think we should ever go beyond those two items. I mean, there's no reason to deliberately offend people just for the sake of poking our finger in their eye. I don't see how that gets us anywhere.
If time had not been so short, I would have told you about our partnership with the United Nations NGO Servas, and it's a way that all of us can show how nice humanists are to the world around us. It was founded in order to build cross-cultural understanding, and we can participate by being home hosts in our own homes, or when we travel in 140 countries around the world, we can have a much more meaningful experience because we are staying with locals who can acquaint us with their culture. So if you're at all intrigued by being an ambassador for humanism in this way, stop by the Feminist Caucus table where we have more information.
Thank you, Stephanie. I think that that's a good suggestion, and it gets to part of the living the good life as humanists and experiencing it with others. And that's so tremendously right down our alley. Thank you.
I'm extremely blissful that the Political Action Committee wants to have a voice in the U.S. government. However, I have a suggestion and a question that will work. I would absolutely love it if the AHA would set up a NGO with the United Nations so that our the things that you guys stand for would be raised to the international community. I think that would be extremely beneficial. Is that something that the AHA would consider?
We do actually have NGO status with the UN. However, we don't have a full-time operation with that. I think that's something that should be in the cards for the future. We are increasing our involvement internationally on our membership in the International Humanist and Ethical Union. We're active in the State Department locally in Washington, D.C. to influence them to make a difference overseas and around the world. But I think that this is definitely an area that we can expand over time, because I think the impact we can have worldwide is limitless.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for inviting our suggestions for the strategic plan. We're starting that as well at the Harvard Humanist Hub. And so I would be interested just to make the restate what you're looking for input, and let's everybody pin it in our minds and maybe have a few, put out some of the straw people to get our brains going. And then when do you specify when you want us to turn in the input? Thank you.
Okay. So I have cards in the back of the room, and you're welcome to also email me, jkalmanson@americanhumanist.org. So if you have a long suggestion that you feel you want to type rather than write, go ahead. I'm looking for answers to the question, in 30 years, the AHA should. So when you're sitting there imagining what your sons and daughters or grandsons and granddaughters want to get out of this organization, what would that be? So do we exist to hold this conference? It's a great conference. About 1% of our membership attends. It's expensive. It's prohibitive for a lot of people to attend. Is there a better way that we could reach the rest of the 30,000? Of our members? What does that reaching you constitute? Is it just getting the Humanist magazine? Do you want to see more local chapter events? Do you want to see more regional conferences with our hand helping to guide them? Do you want to see more services from us? Do you want to see a larger focus on making sure that there are celebrants and chaplains in your local area? Why did you join? What do you want to get from us? And what do you want your children to get from us? So I'm asking you to think as big as you can. We always will end up writing down the plan in too detailed of steps. What we really want is from you the lay of the land. We want the geography. I need you to be the topo map so that we can understand where the peaks and valleys are that we want to attain with our strategic plan. And the only way to do that is to know what you, as members, want from us as your organizational clout. You know, we have Roy and his staff that are capable of doing things. We have a board that volunteers and does things. So, you know, what do you want us to do? Now, keep in mind, there is a strategic plan that already exists. It expired in 2012. We met some of the objectives on that plan, but not nearly all. And I don't know that it was broad enough. So I'm looking for suggestions, whether they're, you know, hold a conference every month. Okay, we're probably not going to be able to do that in the next 5 years. Do you want a retirement home just for humanists? Do you want a school just for humanists? Do you want more emphasis in the digital world, more emphasis in brick and mortar? Can't do both very well. But over the next 20 years, if we have our feet pointed in the right direction, any of those things could come true. Thank you.
Okay, it's quiz time. What's the state of humanism?
Strong.
Strong? How many hands up for strong? Great. What was
dynamic?
Any hands up for dynamic? I want you to understand we're really doing great things, and we just need you all doing great things right along with us. There is something I want you to pay attention to. Make sure you get your email in at the registration table. Maggie has promised that she's going to send out an email after this conference, and in that email is going to be your coupon, your ticket
to save at next year's conference. So, and it's significant. So watch for that email, because Maggie's got a surprise in there for you. Next year's conference is our 75th birthday, our 75th anniversary. We're going back home. We're going to Chicago. So Chicago, the end of May, 2016. And we're going to keep reminding you about that, and we want to look forward to having you all with us then. We're done with this meeting. You've got an idea of the state of humanism as far as AHA is concerned. And once again, there's a board member coffee tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock over in the area where the registration tables are. That means the board is there specifically to talk to you. So come get a cup of coffee or a cup of tea, wake up, and challenge us. Talk to us about something you want to see us doing. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you. And one last little thing. The cards that Jenny mentioned, also there's little cards that had been distributed. You could use those too. Just give them to Jenny or I or Becky, and we'll make sure that they go to the right place and that we keep them in consideration. Thanks.